Say healer.
Thank you. You're everything.
My hope for tomorrow. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we come to you as humble as we know how. Lord God, we ask you to move in this place like never before, God. We just want to thank you for being God. Lord God, thank you for waking us up this morning and giving us the use and activities of our limbs. Lord God, we lift you up in this place, God. We magnify you, we glorify you, we edify you. Lord God, and if you never do anything else, God, you've done more than enough. Lord God, we thank you and we praise you. And it's in Jesus' name. Come on, let the church say amen. Come on, let the church say amen. Come on, let the church say amen. Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Did anybody come to give God a praise in this place today? We came up to lift up the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Does anybody need God in this place? Does anybody need him? Come on, somebody say, Lord, we need you right now. Can y'all put your hands together? Come on, come on, come on. Come on, St. Pete, come on. Come on, come on. Oh, somebody needs you, Jesus. Put your hands together. Come on. Put your hands together. Yeah. Oh, somebody needs you, Jesus.
Right now, Lord.
Somebody needs you.
Right now, Lord.
Somebody needs you, Jesus.
Right now.
We need you,
right now.
Lord, we need you,
right now.
We won't move,
right now.
Till you can hear,
right now.
Right now,
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 Lord, we need you,
right now. Lord, we need you.
Right now, Lord.
Yeah.
Right now,
Lord,
right now,
Lord, we need you.
Right now, Lord.
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 As we're there.
Right now, Lord.
Pass it for.
Right now, Lord.
Pass it for.
Right now, Lord.
Pass it for the water.
Right now,
so does my soul.
Right now, Lord.
My soul thirsts.
Right now, Lord.
And it longs. You.
Right now, right now,
Lord, we need you.
Right now,
Lord, we need you.
Lord,
we need you.
Lord,
we need you. Lord, we need you.
Lord,
we need you.
Lord,
we need you.
Lord,
we need you.
Right now,
we won't move
till
you get here.
We
won't move till you get here. Lord, we need you.
Lord,
we need you. Lord, we need you. Lord, we need you. Lord, we need you. We need you.
Lord,
we need you. Lord, we need you. Lord, we need you. Lord, we need you. Lord, we need you.
Lord,
we need you.
Lord,
we need you.
Lord,
we need you. We need you. We need you.
Oh,
down in my soul cries. Somebody's praying, Lord. Somebody's praying, Lord.
Right now,
Lord, we need you.
Right now,
Lord, we need you.
Right now,
we need you. Lord, 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 we need you. As a deer panting for the water. Oh, my soul longing for to be with you. Oh, my soul wants to be. 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 Right now. Right now.
Right now.
Right now. Oh. Somebody needs you, Jesus.
Right now, Lord.
Somebody needs you. Put your hands together. Come on, if you need him right now. Come on, somebody, put your hands together. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I need him right now. Come on, say, neighbor, I need him right now. You don't know what I'm going through, so I need him right now. Now put your hands together in this place. Come on, if you need him, don't fool me in the building. Don't fool me in the building. If you need him, you gotta say something to him. If you need him, you gotta open up your mouth. If you need him, you gotta lift up your hands. If you need him, you gotta testify to somebody else. If you need him, don't play with me in here. Oh, we need him. Look at your neighbor again and say, neighbor, somebody needs Jesus right now. Come on, say it again. Say, neighbor, somebody needs Jesus right now. Now put your preaching voice on and say, neighbor, somebody needs Jesus right now. Oh, we give him glory. We give him glory in this place. Come on, he's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be praised. We lift him up in this place. Come on, good morning, St. Peter's Missionary Baptist Church. Good morning, St. Peter's Missionary Baptist Church. Good morning, St. Peter's Missionary Baptist Church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can we put our hands together for the SOS dancers? Come on, St. Pete, we do better than that. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
God, I want to be the place where you live, Jesus. Stand in awe of your presence, the beauty of your righteousness. We need a touch from your grace, and here the chains must fall at the power of your word. And here the chains must fall at the power of your word. Right here in this moment, the chains must fall at the power of your word. And every knee must bow and tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. shall be called the house of worship. This shall be called the place of praise. This shall be called the place of Bethel, the place where God lives. This shall be called the house of worship. This shall be called the place of praise. This shall be called the place of Bethel, the place where God lives. Somebody sing it to him. This shall be called the house of worship. This shall be called the place of praise.
This shall be called the place of Bethel.
Amen. Come on, can we give God praise one more time? You can do better than that, y'all. Come on now. You know, these past few weeks, Brother Bowles, these past few weeks in our community, in our local South Dade community, has been a tough one. Amen. I don't think I have to testify too long for any of you for all of us to be able to acknowledge that these storms get rough. And so this morning, before I can even go any further, I was going to do the announcements, but I think it's a good idea to just set the atmosphere and let's get ready for the word. And I want to encourage your heart, because there are things that we go through and we're trying to avoid it at all costs. Sometimes we hide in a substance, whether it's getting high or getting drunk or in a relationship that we shouldn't be in. Or sometimes we hide in depression or in isolation just to avoid the storm. But I've learned something these past month that sometimes, Kendrick, the greatest blessing, the very jewel, the very thing that God is trying to get in your hand, he hides it. And he doesn't hide it under a bush or hide it like digging for a treasure. But sometimes he hides it literally in the midst of the storm. And the only way you can grow to where God wants you to grow, the only way you can experience the maturity that God wants you to experience, is you've got to get in the middle of the storm that God has ordained for you. So they're going to prepare their hearts to minister. And after they minister in song, I'm just going to cut across the field. I want to get to the word. And we'll give you the announcements. There's a few things I want to share with you, but we'll do that later. But I'm encouraged this morning, Dan, because I believe God did it on purpose, man. When I look around this room, I see some of the things that we're experiencing. We're praying for our families. I admit it to y'all, for the last 2 weeks, I had to say it over and over. I had to grow up. Losing someone that's dear to you. And we beg God to not allow these things to happen, but God is saying, I did it on purpose. I hid it in the storm. So, Lil D, I'm glad you came, man. Well, while we prepare for this next song, I want to challenge each one of you, those of you that were with us in Bible study, know that we explored this lesson, and I'll talk a little bit more about it. But I want to challenge you to consider, what has God hidden that I'm avoiding? But what is God requiring of me so that he can finish what he started in my life? So I pray that you're blessed from this. And in case you weren't with us on Wednesday, I want to explore a few things. We're going to be in Matthew chapter number 14. Good to see you, Mother Sumter. I don't know how you snuck in there behind me. Amen. Matthew chapter 14. We're going to begin at verse number 22. And I'll be back to you forefront. Why don't y'all minister to us in song, and let's let the Lord have his way. Amen.
We need you, oh how we need you, oh how we need you, oh. Everybody say we need you.
We need you.
That's the whole song.
Oh,
come on, lift it up. We need you.
We need you.
Oh how.
Oh how.
Come on.
Oh,
come on, can y'all help us say it? We need you.
We need you. Oh, how we need you. Oh, how we need you. Oh,
can I hear y'all say it? We need you.
We need
come
you.
On, say it.
Oh, how
we need you.
We need you.
Oh, come on. Say it again.
We need you.
Oh, how.
Oh, how we need you.
Oh, how.
Oh, how
we need you.
We need you.
Oh, come on, say we need you. Say.
Oh,
say it. We need you.
We need you.
Oh, how.
Oh,
we need you.
We need you.
Oh, how.
Oh, how.
We need you.
We need you.
Oh,
oh.
Say it again. We need you.
We need.
y'all say it.
Oh,
we need.
We need.
Oh.
Oh.
Take it old school for me.
I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior.
I want you to go old school again, but everybody in this building, until we get to the place of total dependency on Jesus, you're never going to find the place of peace that God called you to. You've got to get to the place to where you admit and acknowledge out loud, Lord, I know I'm cool, I'm smooth, I'm blessed, but I need you. I know you've opened doors for me. I know better, but I need you. I'm not on that stuff anymore. I'm not doing that anymore. But Lord, I need you. And we've got to get there on one accord. This ought to be a room full of desperate people crying out to somebody that they know can't nobody help me but you. I need you to get weak before the Lord, get broken before the Lord, get totally dependent on him. I want to take it back. I need thee. I need thee. I need thee. Hallelujah.
I need thee. Oh, I need thee.
Come on, church. Teach it to your children.
Every hour.
That's it. That's it.
I need thee.
Talk to him.
Oh, bless
me
now,
my Savior. Make it personal.
My Savior.
Now, who's coming?
I go to thee. I need
all the young people. The young people, you can move. Children's church right next door, kids' corner. Brother Oscar, you can round them up. Come on, church, lift him up.
Every hour.
Tell
him. Oh, bless. Come on.
Oh, bless me now, my Savior.
Now all over the building. Say that one more time. All over the building. I knew how to say yeah.
To thee.
Yeah.
Got it.
And the church say
yes.
Come on, talk to him.
Yes.
Come on, y'all ain't that grown. Let's do it.
Yes.
Surrender, surrender.
Yes. Yes.
There's only one response. Only one appropriate response.
Yes.
Come on, talk to him one more time. My soul.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Come on, is there a yes in your spirit?
Yes.
Take it low.
Yes. 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 Just Hallelujah. Another day that the Lord has kept me.
Just another day.
One more just time. Another day that the Lord has kept me.
Anybody got a testimony?
He has kept me from all evil. Kept my mind stayed just another day that the Lord has kept me.
Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter number 14. Matthew chapter number 14. Thank you, Lord. You're a very present help in time of trouble. Matter of fact, can you turn to somebody on your left or your right? Give them dap, shake their hand, or pat them on the back, but just tell them it's good to be here. It's good to be here. That's right. Encourage somebody that they're in the right place. Look at Shawnee being sweet. That's what I'm talking about. You just don't know what kind of anointing you may have on your life. Amen. Matthew chapter number 14. The gospel according to Matthew chapter number 14. I believe God loves us so much, Brother Gibson, that he's going to minister to us this morning. I believe that, brother. I believe it. Matthew chapter 14, verse 22. I just want to read in your hearing. This is a very familiar story. You've heard it before. But I beg you, sisters and brothers, don't tune out my voice based on your familiarity with this text. The Bible says, beginning at verse 22, and straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. Somebody say alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. That wind was angry. It was opposing. It was mad. It wasn't a summer breeze. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled. Wait a minute. They saw Jesus and was troubled, saying, it is a spirit, and they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, if it's you, Lord, Jesus, if that's really you, just holler at me, bid me come unto thee on the water. In other words, all you got to do is call my name. And here's what Jesus says, and he said, come. In my Bible, those words are red. Just one red word sticking out in the middle of this whole narrative. Jesus speaks, Aramis, in the middle of this storm. He don't give a paragraph. He's not preaching. He's not giving a whole dialogue. All he says is one word. And when you got any kind of relationship with Jesus, if you got any kind of experience with Jesus, good or bad, somebody say, all I need is a word. Let me finish reading the text. He says one word, and my sheep know my voice. You know what you need to hear. I'm sorry, I'm trying to move on, but this part is personal, Dan. Because to you, he may say, come in. To somebody else, he may say, holler at me. To somebody else, he may snap his finger. To you, he may say, come. But whatever it is, I know his voice. I can't compare him calling me to how he calls you. You've got to know his voice for yourself. This is where it gets personal. You can't hide behind mama's religion or grandmama's religion. Somebody say, he called me. And Peter heard that. Peter saw this flash, bro. He saw it jump out in the middle of the narrative. That thing just blessed me because I don't see nothing but red. That one red word in the middle of all that black. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, the Bible says he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and beginning to sink. He cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand, called him, and said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore did you doubt? Why did you doubt me? And when they were coming to the ship, the wind ceased. Then they that were in the ship came and worshipped him, saying, of a truth, thou art the Son of God. God bless you. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Matthew chapter 14, verse 22 through 33. I want to talk to you for these next few minutes from a very simple topic. He hid it in the storm. Can you repeat that? Say, he hid it in the storm. In this particular passage of scripture, we see these disciples that's been following Jesus, disciples that know him, that he's used. He's done some amazing things in their lives. And here they are trapped in the grip of a major storm. And they find themselves in that storm because, not because of something they did wrong. I mean, if I call out the roll, I don't want you to tell your business this morning, but if I had to call the roll, Miss Shawnee, and ask about some storms, I believe everybody in here can acknowledge, yeah, I've been through some storms. And the other half that's willing to admit it will say, I put myself in that storm. Now y'all want to get quiet. That's how they do me, Dan. I'm going to talk to Dan. Amen. The point is, most of the time, we make a mess of things. Most of the storms we find ourselves in, we can look back and say, if I wouldn't have done this, I wouldn't have been here. Come on, y'all, don't act stuck up today. Amen. We make a mess of things. A lot of the storms, and we call them storms, and we call it the Lord. But most of it is you made a bad decision, and you're dealing with the consequences of your behavior. Do I have a witness here? But what I see in this text is something a little different. This is not the result of doing something wrong. This is not the result of running from Jesus, like most of our storms are. This is not the result of wallowing in sin or enjoying some pleasure that we should be waiting on like most of our lives is, Janique. This is a weird one because this is a storm that came as a result of me listening to Jesus. See, that don't happen to a lot of people because we ain't trying to listen to him in the first place. But if you ever dare to say, I'm going to just do what he says. I'm going to get my life together. I'm going to be obedient. I want to do what's right, baby Bobby. I want to get it together. And if you ever make up your mind to do what Jesus said, you're going to be hit with that reality that sometimes obedience will lead you into the very storm you're trying to run from. Why? So the Bible says here, it says, and straightway, let's start with this first at verse 22. It says, and straightway, Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and to go before him to the other side while he sent the multitudes away. So the first thing I want you to notice in this text when we read this first verse, I want you to notice that word constrained in the King James Version. In other versions, it's compelled, urged them. In other words, it was almost like they had an argument. Jesus trying to tell them to get in the boat, and they're trying to say, no, we're going to hang out right here with you. And Jesus is literally forcing them, Kendrick. He's literally twisting their arm. No, get in the boat. Trust, get in the boat. This is where you need to be. And anybody that's ever tried to make any steps towards Jesus, you'll get to that place to where he'll squeeze you or constrain you. This is where you need to be. This is the direction you need to go. And you may feel inside like, no, there's an easier way. There's a better way. Not yet, not now. But Jesus said, no, this is where I want you to go. Now, I'm talking about three or four of y'all in here that made up in your mind, whatever he tells me to do, I'm going to do it. Watch this. So I asked myself the question, though, Betty, why would Jesus insist that they get in a boat knowing that no matter what they do, right or wrong, they're going to end up in a storm? Why would Jesus send me? He know me. He know how I am. I'm talking, well, he know you. He know how you act. He know the kind of stuff that might come out of your mouth. He knows what happened. As saved as you are, as much as you love Jesus, he knows certain trouble, what it's going to do to you. Y'all don't want to say amen, but I know it's true. Amen. I don't know you, but he knows. I don't know what make you tick, but he knows. And he knows that certain storms is going to come bring something out of you that you thought wasn't in you anymore. Do I have at least one witness? That after changing your mind and making sure I'm going to do right, you ran into something that made you question that decision, didn't you? You ain't got to admit it because you're in church, but y'all know what I'm talking about. I'm the pastor. I'll admit it, Dan. Laid on my face, repented, spoke in tongues all up and down my head. Lord, I ain't going to never do that no more. And next thing I know, as I go and I'm trying to be obedient, I'm doing what the Lord says, and he creates an opportunity that I know he gave me. But soon as I do what he told me to do, all Hades break loose. Well, I can say it because it's in the Bible. All hell break loose. Y'all know what I'm talking about. And it's as a result of not me tripping, not me lying, not me trying to be slick, not me trying to take anything from anybody. But all I'm trying to do is do what the Lord told me to do. And there's a handful of y'all under the sound of my voice. January came, 2024. You made up in your mind what I did last year. Not going to do it this year. Who I dated last year, I'm not going to date this year. What I drunk last year, I ain't going to drink that no more. And we made up all of those minds. And so God gives you some instructions. Then you said, I'm going to follow him. And the very path you followed him into got you in a bind. And you looking around trying to figure out, did I miss him? Where did I go wrong? Am I talking to somebody here? Where did I miss it? I thought I was trying to do right. Why is it that every time I try to do right, something wrong come up? Every time I treat people nice, they take my kindness for weakness. Every time I turn the other cheek, I ain't got no more cheeks to turn. I done turned all four of them, and they slapped all of them. I don't know what else to do. And went over somebody's head, cheeks. So why would Jesus insist that I go in this storm when he knows that no matter what I do, no matter how hard I try, no matter how sincere I am, this storm gonna get the best of me? You're in here, and you found yourself in a position that you cannot get out of on your own. And here you are trying to figure out who did it and why they did it and what evil is present. And it ain't got nothing to do with the devil. He says, I got something for you, Mother Sumter, but the only way you're going to get it, I hid it somewhere. And where I hid it at, it's going to cost you something. But if you just trust me and go where I hid it, you're going to get everything that I promised you. Somebody holler, he hid it in the storm. Y'all, hey, listen, y'all forgive me. Sometimes I'm preaching to me while I'm preaching to y'all. So Miss Betty, I'm going to be a little selfish today, and y'all just going to have to get on board and ride with me, but the Lord is helping me. Because there's some storms, y'all, that's going on in my life, and I don't want them to be there. I want it to go away, but every time I pray, the closer I get to Jesus, the more I realize, son, this storm was designed specifically for you. We're going to name this one Hurricane Scully because I made it for you, my brother. I wish some of y'all understand where I'm coming from. Some of y'all got some storms that's named after you. You know that name, that storm was named after you. It looked like you. It act like you. It raised sand like you. Go on and embrace your hurricane. I'm waiting on them to name one after me. So I asked that, why would Jesus do that? Well, let me explain to y'all. Let me move on. Let me explain. Why in the world would Jesus send me, insist, not just give me an opportunity, but insist, push me into something that I can't handle, into a storm that could really get the best of me, into something that might make me abandon ship, into something that might make me get worse than better, that might make me go back to addiction. It might make me cuss folks out again Why would Jesus do this? Well, I'm glad you asked. The first reason why he did this, he had to constrain them. He had to get them like, y'all, I need y'all to get in this boat, and I need y'all to get on the other side, and I need this crowd to go on and get somewhere. Well, the first one was right after Jesus, when you read the Bible, you'll find that this happened right after Jesus had fed a crowd of people with these fish and these loaves of bread. And he had fed all these people, and he had worked all these miracles, and people were being healed and saved. So now they're ready to take him by force to be the king. Because they knew what this, it was this term called messiahship. And the Jews knew that a messiah is supposed to come. And the way they understood the role of this messiah is that he's going to come in and he's going to overthrow this Roman government. And he's going to establish a theocratic government. That means that the rule and reign of God is over all the earth. John 6:15 said this. It says, when Jesus therefore perceived that they would come and take him by force to make him a king, he departed again into a mountain himself alone. This was just before he sent them on the other side. The point is, Jesus, they were expecting Jesus in a way that God did not intend. They misunderstood the move of God, and they was about to mess it all up. We do that sometimes. God is moving, but we misunderstand his move. And so we get in the way. We testify too soon, or we put in stuff that God didn't say to include. Because let me tell y'all, let me explain, and y'all help me. I got to get on this. They didn't understand that the rule and reign of God over the earth has to start not in the government, but in God ruling and reigning in the hearts of them that govern. Let me say that again. It wasn't so important. What they thought is that we need a theocracy. We need a government that's ruled and reigned by God. But then if you don't deal with the hearts of those that govern, let me explain. Yeah, I know y'all might get mad at me because there's some reds and blues in here, but that's my concern, not only with our government, but with the way we as Christians respond to that government. Can I holler at y'all for a minute? We're expecting that people that are clearly not interested in God ruling in their hearts, but we think that they're going to yield to him in ruling in the land. So we have one party that's so far from God's standard of morality that we'll vote for and celebrate sin and do it all in the name of Jesus. And then you got another party that claims to represent all the Christians. We the evangelicals, or we the ones representing Christians. We the ones selling Bibles for $60 a pop. Y'all know what I'm talking about. But then we're so deeply rooted in hatred, fear, and racism that they are blinded by the presence of evil that exists in the very prayer vigils that they're calling and revivals and doing it all in Jesus' name. We getting it wrong. He said, no, a theocracy is not when I rule over the land, but it's when I rule over the hearts of those that govern the land. And so what God is saying is, what we ought to be praying for is that God move on the hearts of leadership, is that God will cause leadership to yield to who he is. And that's what happens when we get in God's way. And Jesus knew, he knew that if anything, if I let them have their way, they're going to try to pump me up too soon. And they would have had back then the problem that we got now. People that everybody claiming they doing it in Jesus' name, and everybody missing the point. So one of the reasons why he constrained them to move on, because he said the one thing that would calm them down, the one thing that would get them off of the excitement and the hype of being misled is a storm. Because when you go through a storm and you get to toiling and fighting, you'll get over that political stuff. You'll start fighting over things that don't matter. You'll start fighting over things that has nothing to do with anybody's life, and you'll start dealing with things that matters to somebody's soul. Somebody say he hid it in the storm. He constrained him to go because he said it's not my time yet. But another reason why he constrained him to go, because it was time for Christ to move on. They had been over here by the sea, a crowd had showed up. He's preaching good, people eating good, people being delivered. In other words, they having good church. And that's what, there had to be some black folks, because we love to have good church. As long as it doesn't matter if anybody's being delivered, doesn't matter if anything, we don't want to go and do anything for the community, anything else. Let's just sit here and sing some songs and eat some chicken and hold hands and just do it over and over again. The devil is a lie. Jesus said, we got to move on from here. Y'all want to have church in the four walls, and I'm trying to get y'all to tear down the walls. He says, we can't stay here by the water singing songs and just among us. It's time to move on. So he said, y'all got to get in that ship. Y'all got to get in that ship. And the last reason I got to tell you, because this is probably one of the Jesus needed to pray. If you read in your scripture, that very next verse, when he constrained them to get in the boat and he sent the multitudes away, the very next thing that he did, he got by himself and he went to the Lord. because he knew there's an assignment before us, and we can't spend all our time shouting, thinking everything is about blessings being poured on us. We've got to go to God so we can be prepared for the storms that's already ordained for us. And some of us don't realize that the time to pray is not when troubles show up. The time to pray is not when things get so bad that you're about to lose your mind. The time to pray is right now, because you know it's coming. Do I have a praying church? So Jesus knew that these men would need them, and they would need to know that his presence was with them. So here it is, y'all. He constrains them, get on the boat. And so these men, in the will of God, this is what I want you to see now. These men are in the will of the Lord, but we see them struggling against a storm. I'm trying to drive this point home, that you can be right in the midst of God's will, and your very act of obedience could be the very thing that makes life a little more difficult. It makes doors close, make people start tripping that you thought would get nice. You go to work on time now, and you got your uniform right, and you ain't tripping at work. You nice to the customers, and not a boss tripping. Somebody know what I'm talking about? The moment you become faithful, you trying to make sure things are right for the one you're married to, and you're trying to set things up. And the moment you get your mind that I'm going to do it right, trouble come. Can I tell you, he hid it in the storm? Sometimes God will hide the very thing you need in the very storm that you need. So what happened? These men are in the will of God, but struggling. And it don't matter how hard they try, according to verse 24, they cannot get free. Verse 24 says somebody, it says, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves because the wind was contrary. So here they are, stuck on a stone, and they can't get out. Anybody ever been there? You ever been in a place where you find yourself stuck in one of life's storm, and no matter how hard you try, no matter what you do, it seems you can't get any headway. Money come your way and it seems like you got holes in your pocket. You decide to stop tripping and you forgive that person that you thought you could never forgive. And it just seemed like once I forgive them, they gonna act right and we gonna be all right. And the moment you forgive them, they lose their mind. They take your kindness for weakness. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And I've learned that sometimes this is on purpose, because God has something that you need. And the only way you're going to get it is get to where he hid it to. So let me get y'all. There's three simple points I want to make to drive this point home, because I want you to understand God's reason for the trouble and the challenges that we experience in our lives. I've shared as candid as I could about some of my own personal experiences. And I think many of us in our community, I got a little mixed up even with my announcements, because we had two funerals last week, and I was, you know, we were reflecting and encouraging two families. And then when I saw my notes again, I was like, this must be a mistake. That was last week when we had two. But they had to send back up here like, no, Pastor, it's going to be like this for a few weeks. And these are people we know, people we're close to, people that we're dear to. And I can't get, y'all done heard me talk enough about my own personal experience, but God set it up at this time on purpose. So let me explain. What do you mean? Because God's going to do something with these storms. First of all, I want you to, for those of you that's taking notes, I want you to recognize that storms are God's means of transportation. Somebody say transportation. God will use your trouble as a vehicle. It's not always a stumbling block. It's not always a wall. But sometimes the very thing you're running from, God say, no, that's transportation. What do you mean? Well, let me tell you something. The Bible says in verse 25, and in the fourth watch of the night, here's something Jesus did. Jesus went where? Unto them. How? Walking on the sea. I want you to let that marinate now for a minute. In the fourth watch of the night, in the middle of the night, it's almost in the morning. He'd been out there praying all night long. And Jesus goes to them. But the way he gets to them is not floating in the air. He doesn't just appear like he could. He doesn't even just show up in their mind, but he comes in a way that they never thought that he would. He comes walking on the very thing that they thought was there to kill him. He came walking on the sea. The very thing the disciples feared, which was the sea, was the very thing that the Lord used as a vehicle to reveal himself to them. Now, I don't know what that would mean to some of you, but there may be something, that very avenue, that very vehicle of fear, God says, I'm going to use that to get to you. And he'll do that in your life. He'll do that in my life. And I want y'all to notice how Jesus came to them. Let me just walk through them. So first of all, I want you to note this now. Storms are a means of to transport. He'll use it to get to me. That trouble, God says, I'm going to jump on that bus, and that's how I'm going to get to you. If the storm wasn't there, I won't get to you. But because this storm is here, that's the bus I'm riding. It's a means of transportation. So let me explain what I mean by that. Because the way he comes when he uses transportation, first of all, he comes in the face of darkness. Notice what the scripture says. The Bible says that he came to them on the fourth watch. Now, that's any time from 3 in the morning to 6 in the morning. Oh, that's the darkest of the dark. We'll have a praying church. Anybody ever work night shift? Some of y'all know what it's like to work night shift. If you work night shift, you get to work by 11 or 12 o'clock, you good. Yeah, amen. You woke, you good, you walk, whatever your job is, you on point. But let by 3 o'clock in the morning here. Do I have a praying church? Don't tell on yourself, honey. They may be watching. Amen. Y'all know what I'm talking. Oh, it just come from out of nowhere. You good and energetic. Next thing you know, you slobbing and stumbling. You remember, Sarge, when I worked at the prison, I slept at night. I can tell you now. That used to be my boss, y'all. Hey, but serious, y'all, there is something about the fourth watch. The darkest of the dark. The time that it really get bad. I learned this real good when I was serving in the military during the Gulf War and I had to be on guard duty. And it seemed like something about that fourth watch, just before the breaking of day, the sun ain't even almost up yet. Are y'all walking with me here? It's the darkest time of the night. I'm telling y'all, it's even the crickets shut up after 4 o'clock in the morning. It's the darkest and the lowest time. And that's the time Jesus choose to show up. He operates in the midst, in the face of darkness. And I got to say this to somebody. You may be walking in darkness today, wondering where Jesus is. You could be facing one of the darkest days of your life right now, wondering where he is. But Hebrews 13:5 gives us a little bit of encouragement where he says, I will never leave you, neither will I forsake you. Even in your darkest hour, I can't leave you by yourself. Because even in the darkest hours of life, God is still God, and he is still in control of your life. Darkness may move us, but somebody said, don't move God. And I got to break it down and make it plain because I'm not talking about just darkness when the lights go off. I'm talking about darkness when your mind ain't thinking right. Darkness when you thinking about doing something to somebody that you not thought you would never. Oh, y'all know what I'm talking about. That kind of darkness when you start entertaining thoughts that you never thought you would entertain. Some of y'all looking at me like, I know Pastor ain't talking about this up there. Yeah. He don't have dark thoughts. I'm finna talk about you because see, this is where he shows up. It's in that place where you think he will never come when you're in your worst thought process, in your lowest place. That's when he comes in. That's why it was important for us to express our dependency on him, because it's going to get dark for you. You're going to think about things that you never thought you would think about. Your mind will consider doing things that you never thought you would do. There are things that God delivered you from, and truly you are delivered. But in those dark hours, how many of y'all know those thoughts come back up? And that's exactly where he wants you to be, because it's in the darkest hour of the night when you're at your lowest and you're at your best place of dependency on him. Somebody say he shows up in the dark. Solomon reflected on this. Y'all walk with me. In 1 Kings 8:12, look at what Solomon said. The Bible says, then spake Solomon, the Lord said that he would dwell in the thick darkness. In Psalm 139:11-12, while David was reflecting on who God is to us, he says this from the NASB. He says, if I say, surely the darkness will overwhelm me, and the light around me will be my night. Even the darkness is not dark to you, and the night is as bright as the day. Darkness and light are alike to you. This is David reflecting on how God deals with the darkness in our lives. And I know when we in church, dressed up, looking cute, We think darkness is just the people on the streets. That's just people that's on drugs or people that worship devils and conjure up spirits. And that's what the enemy wants you to believe. But how many of y'all know darkness is in the midst of your tears? Darkness can be in the midst of your own depression. You can take yourself down a dark road and you ain't got to conjure up no spirits and light no candles. Don't let the devil fool you. It's in the room, y'all. None of us are so saved and sanctified that darkness don't show up in our lives. And I'm not trying to tell you to be depressed, but I am acknowledging that depression is real. Mental illness is real. And stop lying to yourself. It ain't just the white people. I paused on purpose because we tell ourselves those lies while the whole time the enemy is running rampant on our souls. Help me, Holy Ghost. Because let me be real with y'all. It was in my darkest. It was in my lowest. I'm serious. My closest walk with the Lord was in my lowest in my life. Y'all have heard me stand in the same pulpit and acknowledge and admit and recognize that I had to deal with some depression. And it wasn't just sad tears. Depression ain't just sitting there feeling sorry for yourself. It's a spirit that everything good could be going on in your life, but you can't see it. That you're so dark internally that even the light that's around you is dim to you. It's something when you're on your own mental prison. And don't get so saved and sanctified that you can't acknowledge your dependency on God. I'm saved, I'm sanctified, I have the Holy Ghost. I believe in the presence of the Holy Ghost. I don't care how Baptist we are. I believe the Holy Ghost will take charge of your thoughts, take charge of your life. But I also realize that mental illness is as much physical as it is emotional. And because these bodies are subject to every sickness and manner of disease, mental illness is not excluded from that. I ain't trying to get on no soapbox, but I want to help somebody because too many of our families and our children and our children's children are suffering from a darkness that God is willing to deliver us from. But we're too sanctified, mother. We're too saved. We got our heads in the clouds, and that's for them, and that ain't for us. The devil is a lie. Darkness is rampant in the land. And God, he does that. He does that, Cheyenne, to break us. He does that to humble us so that we can sing the song that we sung just then. Because sometimes, y'all, when the Holy Ghost is on you and the anointing is on you, the anointing feels good, don't it? It looks good on you, too. When you're anointed, that means you're operating in this power that's not from you. God will anoint you on your job. God's anointing will work in you. Can I be honest with you? I've seen God anointing work in somebody that acted the fool, somebody that was unrepentant, but it was God's power, and he uses his power where he chooses to use it. That's why a drunk can preach to you, and he'll go back and get drunk, and you'll get saved, because God uses his anointing where he chooses to. Where we get deceived at, Deke, is because I'm anointed. And I've learned that. I believe that. I don't say this in arrogance. I believe that God has anointed me to preach his gospel. But I got enough sense to know that his anointing don't save me from sin. Or don't keep me from sin. His anointing don't keep me from walking in darkness. His anointing don't keep me from being attacked and challenged. Are y'all listening to me? Because if I'm not careful, I can feel good in the anointing. Sing good in the anointing. Preach good in the anointing. Do all the things that God called me to do in the anointing. But dying and living in darkness. That's why you got to depend totally on him, because he'll use that darkness to get to you, to recognize you is not about you, but it's all about him. David says it's not dark. It's dark to me, but it's not dark to you. So not only does he come in the face of darkness, I told you storms is the mean of transportation. I'm talking a little more than I wanted to now, so let me move. But he also comes not only just in darkness, but he comes in the face of disaster. The Bible says these disciples, they were in the fight for their lives. Mark describes it. He says they were toiling and rowing. This was not a good time. They were struggling against the storm, literally fighting for their lives. Now, why am I going here? Because it wasn't simply about to get bad. It had already gotten bad, and it was getting worse. Some of you are in that right now. It ain't about to get bad. It's bad. And you might as well take a reality check and be honest about that. This is bad. If this continues, I ain't going to be able to take this. Lord, I love you, but I can't keep living like this. I can't keep living under these conditions. I can't keep doing this every day. Whatever it is, somebody say it's already bad. If you find yourself contemplating obeying God, it's already bad. Even if you ain't did it yet, if you're thinking about doing it, it's already bad. Because when they thought all hope was gone, they thought it was all over. Here comes Jesus. Walking on the waves. Because there are times when we feel like we've lost the battle, but he shows up. And I want to remind you that just as sure as the Lord is in control of your blessings, how many of y'all know he's in control of your storms? I want us to stop giving praise, Brother Dan, stop giving credit to the devil and what all he's doing and how strong he is and how he keeps showing up. I was so hurt and disappointed to hear about the shooting that took place in our community. And all that is to add more hopelessness. Here it is, the community is out celebrating and been doing this for the past few years, just celebrating a reunion, celebrating, you know, good grown folks, just celebrating. And guns, bullets go to flying and shooting. And the first thought that comes is, that's why we can't do this no more. And that's just what the enemy wants. He wants hopelessness out of the dark. But God says, I can bring light out of the dark. See, God will use that very thing and say, I tell you what, next Prime Reunion, we're going to start it with a revival, D. We're going to get out there and take it to the Lord first. Take it up a notch. Make the devil regret he tried to shoot somebody on that day. We ought to turn that thing around and let it be a vehicle through the darkness. Let that be the storm that he walk on to bring the saints out. Amen. Don't shut down the reunion. Let's add something to the reunion. Y'all understand where I'm coming from? It's a vehicle. We don't need to get a devil credit out of this. We need to take charge and show them that God can bring a blessing even out of the worst storm. Because when things look hopeless, somebody say, just look around. Because Jesus is about to show up. I know that for a fact. And remember, he may not keep you from going into the storm, but he will certainly keep you in the midst of the storm. I got receipts on that. Y'all remember them three Hebrew boys? He didn't keep them from being in the fiery furnace. But when they looked in there, they was, wait, I thought we threw three in there. Who is the fourth man coming up in there? Are y'all listening to me? And when they came up out of there, you couldn't even tell they'd been in them. They didn't even smell like smoke. God will keep you in the midst of a storm. Y'all thinking I'm making this up? I told you I got receipts. Come here, Daniel. They threw Daniel in the lion's den. Didn't feed the lions all day to make sure that they were hungry. By the time they show up, not only were the lions asleep, but Daniel was asleep too. Daniel wasn't even up paranoid. I would have been up, awake, paranoid, looking at the lions, making sure they stayed asleep. But that's the kind of God that we serve. He will show up right in the midst. He will keep you when you can't keep yourself, when life lets you down, when you make a bad decision. Somebody say, he's a keeper. Because, see, God didn't prevent any of those from going into it. But he saved all of them in the midst of it. And I know I'm being repetitive, but I want to drive this point home, y'all, because what they needed was hidden in the very storm that they dreaded. What he did for them, he'll do the same thing for me, and he was doing it for you. Amen. So that's still his word this morning. Amen. He's not saying that the storm ain't bad. He's not saying that whatever you're going through is not bad. What he's saying is, I'm greater than that. Losing somebody you love, that's bad, but I'm greater than that. Your good being evil spoken of, that's really bad, but guess what? I'm greater than that. An old habit returning that you've been trying to shake, oh, I know that breaks you down, but I'm greater than that. Trying to reach a family member that you can't reach, but you know I can reach him. It's a desperate situation, but guess what? He says, I'm greater than that. So regardless of what you're facing, remember that Jesus is greater than any storm that you might be going through. I'm going to get through this, y'all, but let me just say this. I got to say something else about a storm. I told you they're a means of transportation, but a storm is also a means of revelation. Sometimes God needs to show you something. And he tried to show you with the sun and the shine. You know, he tried to show you through the sweet things, through the blessings. He tried to show you through these beautiful children of God, through your wife, your husband, through a great church you got. He tried to show you, but you ain't see it. So he says, I got another means of revelation for you. If you don't see it like this, you sure gonna see it like that. And he will use a storm, Michelle, just to reveal to you what you need to see. I got a feeling y'all want me to hush. Give me two more minutes. Watch this, y'all. Because you got to hear this. Because what is he trying to reveal? What am I supposed to see when things are this bad? And I can't call out everybody's storm. I can't call out what you're going through. But whatever it is, it's the thing that weighs you down. It causes darkness in your life. It causes you to scratch your head and wonder what you did wrong. And here it is, this preacher saying, no, it's none of that. God wants to reveal something to you. Well, what do you want to show me? Because I've been waiting on my car at my house and I ain't seen that yet. And some of y'all been waiting on your Boaz or your boo, and you ain't seen it yet. So what is he trying to reveal? I'm glad you asked, because the first thing that he's trying to reveal is the very thing that we need to see. First of all, he's trying to reveal the Savior. He wants you to see Jesus in every situation of your life. What do you mean, Pastor? When the disciples saw him walking on the sea, verse 26, they were terrified. And they said, it's a ghost. And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus said something. He said, take courage, it is I. Do not be afraid. He wanted to reveal the Savior. He wanted you to know that sometimes you won't know that he's with you until you get to a place of desperation, that the only thing that can save you is him. And when Jesus did come walking on the water, the disciples didn't even recognize him. He came, but they didn't see him. They thought he was a ghost, and they cried out in fear, not faith. Are y'all listening to me? But thank God Jesus came with a message for them. He came to help them. He came with a message of peace. He said, be of good cheer. Calm down. Chill out. I got this. He came with a message of power. He says, it is I. And when he said, that ought to let you know right there, I got this thing in control. He came not only with a message of peace and power, but he came with a word of potential. He says, be not afraid. You don't have to be afraid because I'm here with you. And that's what the storm does. The storms sometimes, they have the potential to reveal Jesus to us in a way that we may have never considered him before. I can tell y'all personally, I learn more and more about him every time I go through a trial. Every time I experience something that I thought I had it all together. Because when he comes walking on in our storm, he gives us the same message of hope. I'm here. And he comes up declaring his identity. He said, it is I. That's a personal pronoun. And it's the same statement Jesus used when he says, I am the door. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the bread of life. I am the good shepherd. Yo, you get the point? It's the I am of Jesus. And he's telling his disciples to look up. God is here. And if we can ever grasp the truth of Jesus being the great I am, you realize that when he's all you got, he's certainly all you need. So I want to thank God. So let me just, not only do the storms reveal the Savior, I told you it was a way of revelation, but they also do something for us. It reveals Jesus to us, but it refines the saint. It gets us together. Look at what the Bible says about Peter. It says, and Peter said to him, Lord, if it's you, all you got to do is just tell me to come. Bid me to come on the water. He said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water. Not to show out, not to be seen, not because he got his new church suit. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Not because he know how to say it good, or he's a great singer, he's a great preacher, so let me get out here and walk on this water. But my Bible says he went on that water for one reason, to get to Jesus. Now, I'm sure the disciples was impressed, because none of them had ever done it before. We're still impressed talking about this story thousands of years later, but Peter didn't do that to be seen or talked about. He did something great and supernatural for one reason. Jesus called me. He told me to come, so I'm going to go. And if I do something amazing, it's him, not me. Are y'all walking with me here? So he goes, and when Peter heard that it was the Lord, he wanted to join Jesus in walking. So why would Peter go? What was the difference with him? See, Peter knew something that the other disciples seemed to have missed. Peter called something because there's a time of invitation and there's a time of delegation. Let me explain. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 19, we saw Peter's invitation. Everybody say invitation. Yeah, I'm a teacher by nature. Y'all got to walk with me. I ain't finna hoop. I'm going to finish this thing up. I feel like I had to stop and say this because I see some of y'all, and I want you to listen and apply this so that you can apply it to your life. Are y'all walking with me? Everybody say invitation. There's a difference. You see, when he hollered at Peter in Matthew 4, 19, that was the invitation. And he said unto them, follow me and I will make you. Y'all see that? Follow me and I will make you. Follow me and I will make you. What he said to him, I will make you fishes of men. The invitation requires total submission and dependency on Christ. If you don't get the invitation right, you're going to mess up the delegation every time. So here's when the delegation happened in Matthew 10 and 8. Heal the sick. Delegation. Cleanse the lepers. He's delegating. Raise the dead. Delegating. Cast out devils. Freely ye have received, freely give. So while the invitation requires total submission and total dependency on Christ, has nothing to do with me, everything to do with him. The delegation requires absolute commitment to Jesus and compassion towards his people. And the problem is, we try to respond to the delegation without first accepting the invitation. We want to go out and do the stuff because people love when we bring them sandwiches. Y'all know it. That people love when we do kind things, and you want to be a do-gooder. And so we'll do that because that's what Jesus told us to do. But you haven't accepted the invitation. He's got to be Lord and ruler over your life first. And Peter understood that. Peter understood that it don't matter how many demons I cast out. It doesn't matter how much God used me. What matters is I got to submit. And every time he called, I got to get out of myself. Put myself aside and put my ego aside and totally depend on him. And it's difficult in this day and age, Ben, Because it's I me society. It's about independence and doing it without any help from anybody. I got this. And that's the biggest trick the enemy used to deceive God's people. So as I hasten to close this message, I just want to say this to you. Jesus simply told Peter to come. He obeyed and he walked on the water. And of course, Jesus used that storm as a means to help Peter grow in faith, because the moment Peter took his eyes off of Jesus, the moment his focus became anything other than Jesus, and in this case, Peter didn't look at himself. Some of us do that, how we get our eyes off Jesus. We look at ourselves and get impressed. But some of us do just like Peter did. We look at the challenges as opposed to the one that's getting us through the challenge. And how many of y'all know that storm was there when he got out of the boat? The wind was raging just as bad. Whatever it is that you're going through, that thing been there. And sometimes it's not that circumstances change, our perception change. Instead of looking to the one that's helping us, we're looking to the ones that's against us. Friends and families, I hasten to close this message. I want to remind you that Peter had a story that none of the disciples had. He had a testimony that none of them could relate to. Peter was the only one who could say, I walked on my storm. He was the only one that could say, I stepped out and I walked on it. So storm, they come as a means of revelation. They reveal the Savior. They refine the saint, but they also remind the saint. Verse 30 and 31 says, when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. He started sinking. He cried, saying, Lord, save me. And immediately, Jesus stretched forth his hand. Listen, I want to close on this note. I want you to think about where you are in your life right now. In Bible study, I asked this question. We had a little exercise, and I want to challenge you with it. I brought my little notes with me because I said I want to read this because I believe it's going to help somebody as we reflected on it. The question was asked, how does this story intersect with your life right now? Now, I'm closing on this note. Play something slow, bro. And that's all the hoop y'all going to get today. Amen. But I want you to consider, how does this story intersect with your life? And I'm going to give you about five options that I want you to think about. Does it intersect in your life? Maybe sitting in a boat, but you know you need to get out. Maybe that's you. You're in the boat, and you know the Lord is calling you to step out of where you are. You're in a comfort zone. And nothing's going to change. It's as if you're in this boat that's just spinning and toiling in a storm. And the only thing that's going to change your condition is not when the storm changes, but it's when you change and make up in your mind, I'm not going to let anything keep me trapped where I am right now. Is that you? Are you sitting in a boat, need to get out? You know the Lord is calling you out, but your only hindrance is you. Or the second situation. The first was sitting in the boat, but you know you need to get out. And the second one is, you've made up in your mind, but taking a step out of the boat. You're standing. You're not trying to stay there. You're ready to take this step. And you've made up in your mind, and you know you got to take the step. See, that first one ain't even made up their mind. They're comfortable in the boat. But you no longer comfortable. You're ready to take a step, but you're afraid. Maybe it intersects in your life in this third option, walking on water. God has called you out, and here you are doing something that you don't even have the power to do in yourself. God has called you to do something supernatural, and maybe you are there. Sometimes I find myself there. Lord, how do you use me to lead a church? Me, of all people. When somebody comes and share a testimony of something I said or did that helped them, that's like walking on water to me. And sometimes I can be my worst enemy. Because the moment God starts using me, I cower. I get afraid of success. And sometimes there can be a false humility where it's good to be humble, but when you're so humble that you're not allowing God to use you and he's showing you that he desires to use you. Some of you have walked on water, but it wasn't that you doubted God, you doubted yourself. And God is trying to let you know that he's empowering you. Trust God to do in you what you can't do in yourself. Maybe it's this fourth one. Seeing the wind and waves all around you. Are you here where you're more focused on your challenges than the God that's helping you through them? Maybe you're that person that God is really moving in your life and things are going well, but them storms won't leave. He's blessing you, but then they lying on you too. People are celebrating on you this end, and then somebody's tearing you down on that end. The wind. And you can choose what to focus on. You can choose, and maybe you're that one that now you're focusing a little bit too much on the winds and the waves. God has you out of the boat. He has you walking on water. You know he's using you in a way that you can't use yourself, but them winds and them waves got you ready to throw in the towel. Sometimes it's them doubters and liars. People want to bring you down to where they are. They ain't doing nothing, so guess what? They don't want you to do anything. That's the wind and the waves. Or maybe you're that one that's starting to sink. You see yourself sinking. You know you can do better. God has done better in you, but you're sinking. You're going down. And God is saying, this story is for you. You need to catch this while it's happening. You need to stop and pay attention to what's going on around you. Your influence slipping away. And God is using you, and he desires to use you. God has proven to you already that I love you anyway. And you're all caught up in your shame and what you did wrong. And God's saying, I know about that. I can heal you from that. Stop using that as an excuse to sink. You can pull out of this. And then the last one, grabbing Jesus' hand. Maybe there's someone that's at that place and you know you need to grab it. You have sunk far enough. You don't need to go no lower than where you are right now. He's calling you and you know it. And maybe that's the intersection you at where you just need for once and for all totally surrender to him and grab Jesus by the hand. Whichever one of these circumstances apply to your life right now, whichever one of these intersections that I call, sitting in the boat but need to get out, taking the step out of the boat, walking on water, seeing the wind and the waves around you, starting to sink, or grabbing Jesus' hand. I want you to think about that. And in your time alone, your time with the Lord this week, and your time today of reflection, I challenge you to please, sir, please, ma'am, spend some time with the Lord and admit to him where you are. Acknowledge where you are and remind yourself of that promise that he will never leave you, neither will he forsake you. He hid it in the storm. Let's give God praise in this place. Amen. Lord, have your way in this place. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you, God. I thank you for loving us enough to remind us of who you are in our lives. I thank you, Lord, for your grace of hiding our blessings, Lord, right where it needs to be. I pray for these men and women of God this morning. Someone would make a decision to serve Jesus as Lord. Thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, let every child of God say amen. Amen. Let's give God praise. The doors of the church is open. And if you're here, come on, y'all, let's give God praise, because baby girl had already made up her mind. You can come on up. Amen. Come on, Brother Gibson. Listen, I was told before service that one of our youth wanted to give their life to Jesus today. Come on, y'all, let's give God praise. This is young Cairo Gibson. Her mom and dad is here and faithful serving our church. And Cairo and her brother sometimes are among the few children in our children's church. And I'm just encouraged to hear that it's not based on numbers, but that the word of God is being ministered to our children and they're getting it. And if you have any children or grandchildren that you desire to learn about the Lord, please make sure you connect them, because young ladies like Cairo need somebody to disciple and minister to. Amen. So this is a good decision. We're so proud of you. We're going to pray with you, okay? I want you to come down with Mom and Dad and Brother Oscar. Now, while we pray with Sister Cairo, because you're our first fruit today, you planted the seed. If there's anyone here this morning, first of all, that desires salvation, that saw yourself in one of those intersections, and the decision you need to make is to give Jesus Christ your life. It's to allow him to be Lord over your life. Will there be anyone? I was intentional this morning. I took my time on purpose. I wanted you to understand that he does this on purpose Some of the things that we're trying to avoid is what God put in our lives. We need a Savior. Our children need to know who He is, who Jesus is. We need Him to be Lord of our lives. Will there be anyone to receive Jesus as Lord? Amen. Perhaps you desire your prayer. I called out about six categories that may intersect with your life with this sermon. And if you found yourself intersecting with any one of those categories, I just want to pray for and with you while we pray together. Amen. Come on, Miss Tracy. And if you desire, I want you to come and meet me at the altar, because there's somebody here that can relate to you. That's right, brothers. Y'all come and cover my brother, man. Hallelujah. Please, sir. Please, ma'am. Consider what you thought. This is where my life is intersecting. And while we pray for young Cairo and her salvation, we pray for you. And we pray that you do what God is calling you to do, that you hear His voice in this hour in your life, that the storm does not blot out God's voice in your life. Whatever intersection you're at, and those areas are pretty specific. I can call out a few for myself. Please, sir or ma'am, put it in God's hand. And one thing I know for certain, God is going to show you something that you never thought you would see if you're willing to submit to Him. Can we pray? Every head bowed, every eye closed. In the name of Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your word today, God. We thank you for your promise of salvation. God, you said that if we call, you will answer. And you said that if we had faith like these children, Lord God, that we should see you as children see you. So we pray for young Cairo now, Lord God. I pray, Father, that you enter into her heart, Lord, and become Lord over her life. I pray that you give her clarity in her walk with you, Lord. And I pray, Father God, that you would meet her, Lord God. Teach her to pray, Lord God. Surround her with good leadership, Father God. Use her for your service. I pray for the men and women of God standing at the altar, Lord. We've acknowledged a place of intersection in our lives. We see some of Peter's testimony in our own life, God. We recognize your character, Father, and even some of the storms that we're going through. And Father, we make a commitment, a profession right now, that we will not be overtaken by any storm, but we would acknowledge and recognize, oh God, that you are in control. Teach us your way, oh God. Show us your hand, Father, even in the midst of our challenges, Lord. God, I plead the blood of Jesus, Lord, that we're not weary and well-doing. I beg you, God, to minister to your son, minister to your daughters, oh God. Heal every hurt. Somebody's alone in this storm, oh God, and I pray that you remind them that they are never alone, oh God. Let us embrace this time of loneliness. Let us be reminded, oh God, that sometimes you move the multitude on purpose. Nobody's answering the phone on purpose, oh God. You know what you're doing in the name of Jesus. And God, I pray that you be our strength, oh God. We depend on you, God. We can't get through it without you, God. You do things we don't understand. So God, I pray that the storm of death will serve as an avenue to life in the name of Jesus. Have your way, God. You bring the good even out of worst situations. And for that, we thank you. We honor you. In Jesus' name we pray. Let every child of God say amen. Say amen. Come on, give God the best praise you got. To God be the glory. Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you. Praise God. Thank you. I just have a few. Just a few announcements. First of all, I want to encourage us. Let's remember to keep in prayer our bereaved families, particularly Brother Jermaine Mickens, Sister LaFay Mickens, My brother Mickens funeralized his mother yesterday. It was a great homegoing celebration. Sister LaFay was briefly hospitalized after that, so let's keep her in prayer as she is recovering at home and their son, Matthew. Let's just keep that family in prayer. And let's remember our sister, Dr. Betty Ferguson, who's the pastor of Faith in Action and a daughter of this house, and the passing of our dear brother, Deacon Charles Ferguson. He was funeralized yesterday at Mount Moriah. I know some of you were there as a part of that celebration. And let's just keep our community in prayer. Like I said throughout the sermon and over these last few weeks, it's been a tremendous amount of untimely deaths in such a small local area. Let's remember the family of Pastor A.D. Lenoir. His homegoing service is today as well. And that was the pastor that was murdered in North Dade. And he's a partner of ours through the association. So let's keep him in prayer. Also, Brother Quince, I don't know if you got, did you get that the picture? You got it? The king and queen? I got to show y'all the king and queen. On Friday night, through the West Bryan Christian Association, we had our first time doing it, but it was a senior's prom. And you had to be at least 62 and up. And so we have a king and queen, and the king came from our church. So I asked them to put the picture up. I don't know, but there's a prom king. There they are. Is that them? That's right. Y'all give it up for, there they are. Amen. So that was the king and queen, and she's 94 years old. Amen. And Brother Latt, she robbed the cradle. Brother Latimer is 80. Where is he? He's not here today. Amen. But Brother Latimer is in his upper 80s. But it was a very nice time. I didn't make it, amen, but I heard that it was a great time with our seniors, and I'm looking forward to us doing it again for the seniors. But they got really cutified and had their own prom, so I thought that was real nice the way that came out. I do need to say this. For those of you that did register or are planning to register, our deadline is now. So if you do plan to join the Black Multicultural Convention with the church, we'll be going to Orlando July 25th through the 27th, we'll be staying at the Rose in Shingle Creek, and for an individual, that's two nights. You'll be staying at the hotel at the Rose in for two nights for $200 for the individual. For a family that includes two adults and as many children as you can handle, it's $400. However, we do need your deposit today. And the reason is we've got to know who's actually going. The church is going to have to put forth the rest of the money. So your deposit is not refundable. If you prefer, if you're not ready to pay the deposit, but you think you may want to go, we'll be glad to give you the information. You would have to register individually. We're just trying to get our group registration locked in. So sir or ma'am, if you're going individually, it's 25%. So you pay $50 for a family, you pay $100 as a down payment so that we can go ahead and move forward. So please, sir or ma'am, make sure you see Sister Tamika. Let her know your intentions. Otherwise, we're going to have to cut the group size down and go forward with, you know, those that have secured their deposit. So I'm praying that you can go ahead and take care of that today, or at least speak with Sister Tamika to let her know exactly what your intentions are. And of course, if you still like to register, you have today to do it, but we need you to go ahead and state your intentions so that we can seal that up. And we would love, I want as many of you to go as possible. I would love more children to come along. We don't have very many registered, but there's certainly room, and there'll be classes and activities for children as well. As soon as we have the itinerary, those of you that have registered, you will get a copy of that. And I'm asking that you register on Church Track if you can. If you're not registered on Church Track or you don't have that access, stop by the table in the back and make sure we get your name, and we'll add you to the registration. We want to encourage you to save a life today and donate blood. You receive a $20 gift card. I can't give blood, but I can receive gift cards. So you get a blood, give me your gift card. Amen. I joke about that. I was in Europe during the time when the Cold War was and the wall came down. So they don't want our blood, I guess. But I am encouraging as many of you that can. We do as a church. This is a part of our service to our community. So those of you that can and will, I ask that you will stop by there outside now, if I'm not mistaken. Correct? All right, so thank you, Deaconess Brown, Mother Brown, for organizing that for us. We do have baptism this Wednesday, as we do every the last Wednesday of every month. And so this Wednesday, we do have baptism. Please make sure you speak to your deacon or any leader in the church that you can connect to so that we can arrange for you to be baptized. And Friday is Freestyle Friday for Youth Ignited. So I look forward to that. Every Wednesday, we pray, y'all. So I want to see you here. We must pray every Wednesday at 6 o'clock p.m. I'd love to see your face in the place. Amen. And that's all the announcements I have. So what did I miss? Okay, that's right. The sisters, if you can, immediately following service, Lady Brooks would like to share a word with you. She's going to be real quick. Amen. She said just a real quick word. So those of you that can, if you would just come over this side so Lady Brooks can give you some information. That's all I have. I'm going to wait the next week. Amen. So the National Day of Prayer is the first Thursday of the month. And I have an announcement for you, but I just mark your calendars. The first Thursday in May, we're going to be here for the National Day of Prayer. It's at 5 o'clock. So we're gonna have a meal, but we're partnering with a few of our Jewish brothers and sisters. So Temple Beth Am and Beth Or will be coming here to our church, and I let them know up front. Now when we go to y'all, we respect, you know, but we Christians over here and we pray in Jesus' name. So that's how it's going down, and I'm so looking forward to partnering with our Jewish brothers and sisters and you. We're gonna have a meal ahead of time and then a service of fellowship and prayer immediately following that. So I pray that you can do that. If everyone would stand, any visitors, anybody visiting, any of our first time guests, amen. I see you, Lil D. Yo, Lord, this is my friend, Lil D. Wave your hand, D, so I can put you on blast. Amen. God bless you. He lied to me and told me he wasn't coming to church today, but look at God. Amen. So I'm glad to see you and his wife, Bridget. God bless you, Nurse Bridget. Thank you all for coming in. Anybody else visiting today? God bless you, ma'am. Thank you so much for coming. Y'all look like us. God bless you. Thank you for coming. For real, y'all know how some people can look like they go to your church. I'm like, I don't know their name, but I think they go here. God bless you all. Thank you. You could have chose any church, but you chose ours, and we thank you. Good to see you, Ducky. I ain't going to mess with you, though. Amen. God bless y'all. Have a great day, everybody. We love you, and we thank God for you. Let's quote Micah 6 and 8 together. He has shewed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee, but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. God bless and keep you is our prayer. Have a wonderful Sunday. Make sure you give on the way. I believe. God believe. I believe.